Part 3. Broken.
The moment has come to talk about our brokenness. You are a broken man. I am a broken man. And all the people we know or know about are broken. Our brokenness is so visible and tangible, so concrete and specific, that it is often difficult to believe that there is much to think, speak, or write about other than our brokenness. From the moment we met, we spoke about our brokenness. You wanted something about me for the Connecticut section of the New York Times. I told you about my writing as a means of dealing with my loneliness, my sense of isolation, my many fears, and my general sense of insecurity. When the discussion shifted to you, you spoke about your discontent with your job, your frustration at not having enough time or money to write your own novel, and your general confusion as to the course of your life. In the year that followed our first encounter, we became increasingly open to each other about our suffering and pain. In fact, the sharing of our deepest struggles became a sign of our friendship. You had to live through a painful separation and divorce, and I through a long period of depression. You had many disappointments in your work and kept wondering about your true calling in life, while I kept being overwhelmed by the many demands made on my time and energy that often lead me to exhaustion and despair. Whenever we met again, we became more aware of the brokenness of our lives. There's nothing abnormal about this. When people come together, they easily focus on their brokenness. The most celebrated musical composition, the most noted painting and sculpture, and the most read books are often direct expressions of the human awareness of brokenness. This awareness is never far beneath the surface of our existence, because we all know that none of us will escape death, the most radical manifestation of our brokenness. The leaders and prophets of Israel, who were clearly chosen and blessed, all lived very broken lives. And we, the beloved sons and daughters of God, cannot escape our brokenness either. There are many things I would like to say to you about our brokenness, but where to begin? Perhaps the simplest beginning would be to say that our brokenness reveals something about who we are. Our sufferings and pains are not simply bothersome interruptions of our lives. Rather, they touch us in our uniqueness and our most intimate individuality. Our brokenness is truly ours, nobody else's. Our brokenness is as unique as our chosenness and our blessedness. The way we are broken is as much an expression of our individuality as the way we are taken and blessed. Yes, fearsome as it might sound, as the beloved ones, we are called to claim our unique brokenness. Yes, as we have to claim our unique chosenness and our unique blessedness. I must try now to get a little closer to our experience of being broken. As I've said already, this is a very personal experience. And in a society in which you and I live, it is generally an experience of our inner brokenness, a brokenness of the heart. Although many people suffer from physical and mental disabilities, and although there is a great amount of economic poverty, homelessness, and lack of basic human needs, the suffering of which I am most aware on a day-to-day basis is the suffering of the broken heart. Again and again, I see the immense pain of broken relationships between husbands and wives, parents and children, lovers, friends and colleagues. In the Western world, the suffering that seems to be the most painful is that of feeling rejected, ignored, despised, and left alone. In my own community, with many severely handicapped men and women, the greatest source of suffering is not the handicap itself, but the accompanying feelings of being useless, worthless, unappreciated, and unloved. It is much easier to accept the inability to speak, walk, or feed oneself than it is to accept the inability to be of special value to another person. We human beings can suffer immense deprivations with great steadfastness. But when we sense that we no longer have anything to offer to anyone, we quickly lose our grip on life. Instinctively we know that the joy of life comes from the ways in which we live together, and that the pain of life comes from the many ways we fail to do that well. It's obvious that our brokenness is often most painfully experienced with respect to our sexuality. My own and my friend's struggles make it clear how central our sexuality is to the way we think and feel about ourselves. Our sexuality reveals to us our enormous yearning for communion, the desires of our body to be touched, embraced, and safely held, belong to the deepest longings of the heart and are very concrete signs of our search for oneness. It is precisely around this yearning for communion that we experience so much anguish. The fragmentation and commercialization of our milieu make it nearly impossible to find a place where our whole being, body, mind, and heart, can feel safe and protected. Whether we walk on the streets of New York or Toronto, it is hard not to be pulled out of our center and experience in our own bellies the anguish and agony of our world. The AIDS epidemic is probably one of the most telling symptoms of our contemporary brokenness. There, love and death cling to each other in a violent embrace. Young people, desperate to find intimacy and communion, risk their very lives for it. It seems that there is a cry reverberating through the large empty spaces of our society. It is better to die than to live in constant loneliness. Seeing AIDS patients die, and seeing the spontaneous generosity with which their friends form community to support them with affection and material and spiritual help, I often wonder if this horrendous illness is not a clear summons to conversion directed to a world doomed by competition, rivalry, and ever-increasing isolation. Yes, the AIDS crisis demands a wholly new look at our human brokenness. How can we respond to this brokenness? I would like to suggest two ways. First, befriending it. And second, putting it under the blessing. I hope you will be able to practice these ways in your own life. I have tried and try constantly, sometimes with more success than others. But I'm convinced that these ways point in the right direction as means for dealing with our brokenness. The first response, then, to our brokenness is to face it squarely and befriend it. This may seem quite unnatural. Our first, more spontaneous response to pain and suffering is to avoid it, to keep it at arm's length, to ignore, circumvent, or deny it. Suffering, be it physical, mental, or emotional, is almost always experienced as an unwelcome intrusion into our lives, something that should not be there. It must be avoided at all costs. When this is indeed our spontaneous attitude toward our brokenness, it is no surprise that befriending it seems at first masochistic. Still, my own pain in life has taught me that the first step to healing is not a step away from the pain, but a step toward it. when brokenness is, in fact, just as intimate a part of our being as our chosenness and our blessedness, we have to dare to overcome our fear and become familiar with it. Yes, we have to find the courage to embrace our own brokenness, to make our most feared enemy into a friend, and to claim it as an intimate companion. I'm convinced that healing is often so difficult because we don't want to know the pain. Although this is true of all pain, it's especially true of the pain that comes from a broken heart. The anguish and agony that results from rejection, separation, neglect, abuse, and emotional manipulation serve only to paralyze us when we can't face them and keep running away from them. When we need guidance in our suffering, it is first of all a guidance that leads us closer to our pain and makes us aware that we do not have to avoid it, but can befriend it. My own experience with anguish has been that facing it and living it through is the way to healing. But I cannot do that on my own. I need someone to keep me standing in it, to assure me that there is peace beyond the anguish, life beyond death, and love beyond fear. But I know now at least that attempting to avoid, repress, or escape the pain is like cutting off a limb that could be healed with proper attention. The deep truth is that our human suffering need not be an obstacle to the joy and peace we so desire, but can become instead the means to it. The great secret of the spiritual life, the life of the beloved sons and daughters of God, is that everything we live, be it gladness or sadness, joy or pain, health or illness, can all be part of the journey toward the full realization of our humanity. It's not hard to say to one another, all that is good and beautiful leads us to the glory of the children of God. But it is very hard to say, but didn't you know that we all have to suffer and thus enter into our glory? Nonetheless, real care means the willingness to help each other in making our brokenness into the gateway to joy. The second response to our brokenness is to put it under the blessing. For me, this putting our brokenness under the blessing is a precondition for befriending it. Our brokenness is often so frightening to face because we live it under the curse. Living our brokenness under the curse means that we experience our pain as a confirmation of our negative feelings about ourselves. It's like saying, I always suspected that I was useless or worthless, and now I'm sure of it because of what is happening to me. There's always something in us searching for an explanation of what takes place in our lives. And if we have already yielded to the temptation of self-rejection, then every form of misfortune only deepens it. When we lose a family member or friend through death, when we become jobless, when we fail an examination, when we live through a separation or a divorce, when a war breaks out, an earthquake destroys our home, the question, why, spontaneously emerges. Why me? Why now? Why here? It is so arduous to live without an answer to this why, that we are easily seduced into connecting the events over which we have no control with our conscious or unconscious evaluation. The great spiritual call of the beloved children of God is to pull their brokenness away from the shadow of the curse and to put it under the light of the blessing. This is not as easy as it sounds. the powers of the darkness around us are strong, and our world finds it easier to manipulate self-rejecting people than self-accepting people. But when we keep listening attentively to the voice calling us the beloved, it becomes possible to live our brokenness not as a confirmation of our fear that we are worthless, but as an opportunity to purify and deepen the blessing that rests upon us. Physical, mental, or emotional pain lived under the blessing is experienced in ways radically different from physical, mental, or emotional pain lived under the curse. Even a small burden perceived as a sign of our worthlessness can lead us to deep depression, even suicide. However, great and heavy burdens become light and easy when they are lived in the light of the blessing. What seemed intolerable becomes a challenge. What seemed a reason for depression becomes a source of purification. What seemed punishment becomes a gentle pruning. What seemed rejection becomes a way to deeper communion. And so the great task becomes that of allowing the blessing to touch us in our brokenness. Then our brokenness will gradually come to be seen as an opening toward the full acceptance of ourselves as the beloved. This explains why true joy can be experienced in the midst of great suffering. It is the joy of being disciplined, purified, and pruned. Just as athletes who experience great pain as they run the race can at the same time taste the joy of knowing that they are coming closer to their goal, so also can the beloved experience suffering as a way to the deeper communion for which they yearn. Here, joy and sorrow are no longer each other's opposites, but have become the two sides of the same desire to grow to the fullness of the beloved.